Recorded Books Incorporated presents an unabridged recording of Thursday, the Rabbi Walked Out by Harry Kemelman, narrated by George Guidall. This work, copyrighted 1973 by Harry Kemelman, is recorded by arrangement with his estate and the Scott Meredith Literary Agency. This recording is copyrighted 1998 by Recorded Books Incorporated. Barnard's Crossing is a small town with a perfectly capable police department. So if the murder victim had not been a notorious anti-Semite, Rabbi Small might never have become involved. And now, Thursday, the Rabbi Walked Out.
Chapter 1. When her husband was preparing a sermon, Miriam was careful to stay out of his way, not for fear of disturbing his train of thought, but lest she give him an excuse for interrupting his work. For David Small, the rabbi of Barnard's Crossing Conservative Temple, did not like to prepare sermons, or for that matter to preach them. He had begun, as usual, by laying out paper, sharpening pencils, adjusting the lamp, all to postpone the agony of beginning. He was thin and pale, and sitting over his desk, his shoulders had a scholarly stoop. His thin hair, which was beginning to gray at the temples, did not make him more distinguished-looking, only older. He wrote a few words, peering down at the page nearsightedly through thick-lensed glasses. He crossed them out, drummed his pencil on the desktop, and then began to doodle, the sermon forgotten, as he became completely engrossed in working out a complicated design of straight lines and loops, of circles and squares joined by cross-hatching. He was delighted when the doorbell rang. "I'll take it," he called out from his study. Hurrying in from the kitchen, Miriam said, "Don't bother, it's probably the newsboy come to collect for the week." But when she opened the door, it was to the pleasant, ruddy face of Hugh Lanigan, Barnard's Crossing's police chief. From behind her, the rabbi greeted him cheerfully. Come in, chief. Miriam was just going to make some coffee, weren't you, dear?" Dutifully, Miriam said, "Yes, I put the perk on. Do come in." She could not refrain from adding, "David is working on a sermon, and I knew he'd want an excuse for stopping." Lanigan smiled. "What's the matter, David? Having tough going with this one?" "David has tough going with all his sermons," said Miriam tartly. She was small, and in sweater, skirt, and loafers, she might have looked like a teenager were it not that her face, with its pointed chin, showed maturity and determination. Her mass of blonde hair piled on her head, as though to get it out of the way, almost seemed to overbalance her trim little figure. "That's so. I would have thought you'd enjoy it," said Lanigan. "You can bawl them out and they can't answer back. It's a captive audience." The rabbi grinned. "I don't care too much about bawling out people, especially when I'm all too conscious of my own shortcomings. Besides, it doesn't do any good. The sermon is just a kind of entertainment the rabbi provides to help pass the tedium of the service. Actually, it's not even his traditional function. In the old days, the rabbi didn't do it." "You mean when a synagogue engaged a rabbi, they didn't expect him to preach?" The rabbi shook his head. "It wasn't the synagogue that engaged him, it was the town, or the community. And they engaged him to act as a judge and settle questions of law when they arose. The rest of his time he was supposed to devote to study."
"They'd pay him just to study?"
"Why not? Universities subsidize scholars, why shouldn't a community?"
"I suppose. And he didn't have to preach at all?"
"His contract called for 2 sermons a year, on the Sabbath before Passover and on the Sabbath before the Day of Atonement. But they weren't really sermons as you think of them. They were dissertations, like the lectures of a law professor. He didn't exhort the congregation, the kind you're familiar with. Against sin was usually given by an itinerant preacher called a magid. Of course, nowadays the rabbi, like the priest and the minister, is expected to give a sermon every week. Some rabbis like the idea. I suppose they have a knack for it. The poorest student in my class at the seminary now has one of the most prestigious pulpits in the New York area on the strength of it. He has a wonderful baritone voice and can bring tears to your eyes just reciting the alphabet. We call him the voice. Reuben Levy? Asked Miriam. The one who explained about the parables? The rabbi laughed joyously. That's the one. To Lanigan, he explained, we were sitting around once, a bunch of seminary students and their wives, talking about sermons, because at the time we were being sent out to small communities for a Sabbath. Levy explained that in preparing a sermon, he didn't search for examples and parables to illustrate some point he was planning to make. He worked it in reverse. When he heard a good story, he'd keep it in mind and then build a sermon around it. Like the fellow who got a reputation as a crack shot by firing first and then drawing a target around the bullet hole? Suggested Lanigan. Exactly, said the rabbi. As Miriam went out to the kitchen for the coffee, the rabbi went on. My own sermons are always of the dissertation type. You see, three times a week we read portions of the Pentateuch, so I tie in my sermons with the portion of the week.
Then you always have a subject, said Lanigan. That should make it easy.
True, but after all these years, I begin worrying that I might be repeating myself.
Ah, well, said Lanigan, as he accepted the coffee cup from Miriam, have you ever thought that your congregation might not be listening anyway?
The rabbi smiled sourly. Thanks.
No, but seriously, you've been here 10 years now?
12.
So if you were to give some of your old sermons, the ones you gave when you first came, who'd know the difference?
I'd know, said the rabbi.
But look here, you say your sermons are like a professor's lectures. Well, they give the same lectures year in and year out, don't they? I mean, a new class comes in and they have to cover the same ground. Now, I'll bet that in the 12 years you've been here, a pretty fair hunk of your original congregation has gone. Died, moved away, retired to Florida. And a lot of new folks have come into town, so if what you told your original congregation was important for them to know, it's just as important for the new ones to know.
The rabbi nodded. That's true enough. It happens gradually, so you'll hardly notice it, but it's true. There aren't many of the original members left.
And a lot more of your people have moved into the area, Lanigan pointed out.
We have almost 300 families now, said Miriam.
300? Lanigan repeated. I would have thought there were more than that in town.
Oh, there are, in town, the rabbi agreed. Maybe another couple of hundred families, but they're not members of our temple. He smiled.
If Henry Maltzman, our president, has his way, they'll all join up. He's very strong for building up the numbers. He laughed. He's always talking about finding the right gimmick to do the trick. Well, why aren't they members? Now, in our church, when someone moves into the parish, the pastor or one of his curates calls on him. And if he doesn't show up, they keep after him. I bet there aren't a dozen Catholics in town who aren't connected with the church one way or another.
Your religion is church-oriented, said the rabbi. It's built around the Mass and communion and confession, and these involve a priest and a church. Our religion is primarily centered in the home. The Sabbath is celebrated in the home. The Passover feast takes place in the home. Besides, the financial structure of the two is different. Ours is based on membership, and the annual fees of necessity come to several hundred dollars a year. That's a lot for a young married couple, and that's what most of the new people are. They came because they got jobs in the research labs and automated plants on Route 128. And a lot of those are cutting back, Miriam observed, and some may go out of business altogether.
You thinking of the Rorbo Corporation? Asked Lanigan.
There's been talk of it, said Miriam. I know some of the wives are worried.
I saw an article in the Sunday papers, said her husband, about some big Chicago outfit taking it over.
The Siegel Group? Lanigan shook his head. They're not likely to be of much help. The article was mentioned at the selectmen's meeting last night. And Al Megram, who is a stockbroker and ought to know, said they were a financial outfit, not an operating company. They trade corporations like kids trade baseball cards. They take over a company and milk it, manipulating the stock while they liquidate the assets, and then move on, leaving a bunch of empty buildings.
He put down his coffee cup and sat back in his chair.
Did you hear anything about the meeting?
The rabbi shook his head. Lanigan shifted uncomfortably in his chair. He cleared his throat and said,
Well, they voted to reconsider setting up the traffic lights near the temple.
But they approved it unanimously last week, said Miriam, dismayed.
After spending weeks discussing it, added her husband, did anything happen to change the situation? We have children going to the religious school every afternoon, and...
I know, David. It's probably just routine, said Lanigan.
Routine? To pass a measure 1 week and reconsider it the next?
Well, Ellsworth Jordon...
Know him?
The rabbi shook his head. He owns some land down there. Hell, he owns land all over town. But that makes him an abutter. He wrote them that he hadn't been notified. So Megram asked for reconsideration, and the rest of the board went along out of courtesy to him.
So what happens now? Asked Miriam.
Oh, they'll take it up again next week, said Lanigan soothingly, and I expect they'll pass it. But I'd plan on being there, he added.
How about a delegation? Asked Miriam.
Lanigan hesitated.
No, I don't think so. They might feel you were trying to pressure them, and they might resent it. This is New England, after all, and the selectmen are all conservative Yankees. They can get stubborn, not to say mulish, against pressure. That's just my opinion, you understand.
She looked questioningly at her husband.
I think the chief is right, said the rabbi. But I'll talk to Henry Maltzman. He's coming here tonight.
As Miriam cleared the table of cups and saucers, the rabbi walked their guest to the door.
What's really behind this vote for reconsideration?
He asked.
Is it just that this Jordon is indignant that the selectmen failed to notify him?
Lanigan halted on the threshold.
In a town this size, you hear things about all kinds of people, and I listen because I find it comes in handy sometimes in doing my job. I have the feeling that he did it because he doesn't like you people.
Doesn't like Jews.
Chapter 2. Henry Maltzman was a big man. Although he had developed something of a paunch since the days when he had been a captain in the Marines in the Korean War, he still kept his head erect, with the chin in and shoulders back, as though on parade. While at 50 it seemed a little unnatural, like a fat man at the beach sucking in his belly at the approach of a pretty girl, it was generally agreed that he was a fine figure of a man, even handsome, with ruddy cheeks and close-cropped, crinkly hair. It was rumored that he had an eye for the ladies, and vice versa. And perhaps there was some indication of his appeal in the very fact of his election to the presidency, for he had been a rank outsider in the Temple organization, having served only one term on the board of directors before running for the presidency after the bylaws had been changed to permit women to vote and to hold office. Maltzman's bulk loomed large as he looked down at the Smalls. He had little blue eyes, which normally sparkled with friendliness, but which could also turn steely when he was crossed, and which seemed to protrude dangerously when he was angry. His eyes were friendly now as he shook hands with the rabbi, and he favored Miriam with the warm smile that came automatically for women as she took his coat to hang in the closet. He took the seat to which the rabbi motioned him, but he immediately rose again when Miriam returned from the hallway.
"Oh, you are probably going to talk temple matters," she said, "so I'll leave you."
"I wish you would stay, Mrs. Small," he said. "It's about the temple, of course, but it concerns you, too. At least I think it does. It's the place of women in the temple service I want to talk about, Rabbi."
"Wouldn't you like some tea or coffee?" asked Miriam.
"No, really, nothing."
"David?"
"Nothing for me, Miriam."
Maltzman waited until she was seated before sitting down himself. "Now that we have women on the board," he said, "there has been considerable pressure to have full equality in the services. And, of course, something like this can't be decided by a simple majority vote of the board. We'd have to have a referendum or hold a general meeting to decide on something as basic as that."
I agree that it isn't anything that should be decided by the board alone, said the rabbi. So why not hold a general meeting?
Because the other side won't abide by the vote, said Maltzman, showing annoyance. Kaplan, who represents the Orthodox element as much as told me, that if we made the change and permitted women to be part of the minion and called them to the reading and all the rest of it, he'd pull out. He and his group would leave the temple.
The rabbi nodded. Yes, I expect he would. I don't know how many would go along with him, but if there were enough to get another synagogue started, I imagine others would follow.
That's the way I see it, Maltzman agreed. So it seems to me that this is the time to show some leadership. Now, if the rabbi of the congregation were to push for equality, give sermons on it...
Don't count on me, Mr. Maltzman, said the rabbi quickly.
You mean you're against it?
But why? Maltzman was honestly perplexed. The rabbi smiled. Put it down to a natural traditionalism, if you like. If we make so drastic a change, other effects follow, quite unforeseen effects, and some of them undesirable. It's a basic sociological law that you can't change just one thing.
Then you mean you'd be opposed to any change at all?
No, I'm not opposed to change as such, but I'm opposed to unnecessary changes. It seems to me that this particular change is part of the present ferment of the women's lib movement, and as happens in the initial stages of any movement, you get all kinds of exaggerated reactions. A men's club must admit women or it's sexist. You mustn't say chairman, you now have to say chairperson. I was present at a lecture when the speaker used the phrase, every man for himself. He was challenged by a woman in the audience and had to say, every man or woman for himself or herself. Ridiculous. Look here, we are an institution going back several thousand years. Are we to change because there has been a sudden shift in fashion? Would you have us change the traditional Kol Nidre chant because the musical fashion is rock and roll?
But there have been changes, Rabbi.
Sure, when it was practical and necessary. The prose bull of Hillel changed the laws of the sabbatic year when it was necessary to carry on the commerce that had developed at the time. Rabbi Gershom changed the marriage and divorce laws, not to mention the many laws we changed when they became moot with the destruction of the temple in Jerusalem. Our own conservative movement was launched and developed to meet the challenge of the American experience. Changes were made when needed, but only when needed. The rabbi paused, and when Maltzman didn't respond, began again, his voice rising. They want to be part of the minion? Why? The minion is for the purpose of public prayer. It requires a minimum of 10 adult males. If any others want to join, men or women, they are more than welcome. But we just barely make our 10 every morning, and it is Kaplan and his group of Orthodox whom we count on. No matter what I urge or what the board of directors decrees, if they don't see 10 adult males, they will not regard it as a minion, and they won't participate in the service. As for the honor of being called to the reading, that's what it is, an honor. Only a handful at any service are called. Does that mean that the rest of the congregation are discriminated against? It's really more of a social than religious honor, and there are people who have never been called all their adult lives.
What if the congregation as a whole votes for it? Asked Maltzman.
Ah, that's something else. If a sizable majority of the congregation wanted it, it would indicate that a major sociological change had taken place in the community and that this was an expression of it.
Maltzman looked uncertainly from the rabbi to his wife and then said,
How do you feel about it, Mrs. Small?
Miriam laughed. To tell the truth, Mr. Maltzman, there have been some terribly cold and snowy days in the winter when David has gotten up early and gone to the temple to ensure the likelihood of a minion. I remember snuggling deeper into the bedclothes and thanking God that I had no such obligation.
Maltzman grinned.
Yeah, I suppose. All right, I'll tell them how you feel about it, Rabbi.
His grin broadened.
And how you feel about it, Mrs. Small. It won't end the matter.
I know, said the rabbi. My calendar shows a meeting with a delegation from the sisterhood.
He turned to Miriam.
Perhaps now Mr. Maltzman would like a cup of tea?
I would,
She looked questioningly at Maltzman, and after a moment's hesitation, he said, "Well, all right. Yes, I think I'd like a cup now." Miriam immediately left the room, and Maltzman said, "You know, Rabbi, I don't agree with you. I don't agree with you at all on this matter. Other congregations, and conservative congregations at that, have women participating in the services. They've got rabbis, too, so I suppose there are arguments, I mean, rabbinic arguments on the other side." "It's a matter of where you want to put the emphasis," Rabbi Small agreed affably. "Well, with me, the emphasis is on membership," said Maltzman. "I see a lot of our people in the community, and they are not members of the temple. This could be just the gimmick that would get some of them to join." "Would more join than we'd lose if the Orthodox pulled out?" demanded the rabbi. "It's a consideration," Maltzman admitted. Miriam came in with the tea, and as she handed Maltzman his cup, she said, "Did you hear what happened at the selectmen's meeting last night? Was it reported to you?" He listened intently as the rabbi told of Lanigan's visit. "Oh, that son of a bitch, that dirty anti-Semitic son of a bitch. I'm sorry, Mrs. Small, but..."
"You mean Megrim the selectman?" asked Rabbi Small.
"Oh, no, Megrim is all right. I was referring to Ellsworth Jordon."
"Why do you call him anti-Semitic?" asked the rabbi. Maltzman glared. "What other reason is there for him to oppose the traffic light? He's against it because we're for it. Let me tell you something about Jordon, Rabbi. He owns land all over town, and I'm in the real estate business, so I have some sort of contact with him. And not once have I been able to deal with him. He owns land under various titles, Jordon Realty, Ellsworth Estates, E.J. Land Corporation."
"E.J. Land Corporation?"
Miriam echoed. Maltzman nodded.
"That's right. The company that owns the land near the temple that we've wanted to buy for the new religious school. I wrote E.J. Land Corporation asking the price of the lot, and I got no answer. No answer at all. So after a while, I asked my good friend Larry Gore at the Barnard's Crossing Trust, because you write to E.J. Land Corporation, care the bank. I asked him what gives, and he tells me the land is not for sale. So what is it for? Jordon is crazy about paying taxes? He's planning to farm it?
Maybe he's planning to build," the rabbi suggested mildly.
"Practically next door to the temple? Nah. He's crazy, but not that crazy. Besides, he hasn't built in 20 years. Back then, he put up some houses. He's an architect or an engineer of some kind, and sold them at just the right time. Then he bought up a lot of land, planning to build lots of houses, big housing projects, but he got sick and didn't go ahead with it. Well, just about then, land values began to climb. They'd built the bridge and the tunnel, so getting into Boston was a matter of 30 or 40 minutes, and the town became suitable for all year-round living instead of just a summer vacation place for the rich. Land values climbed, and he had acres of it. Some of it could be sold for more than 10 times what he paid for it. He's a crackpot and a nut, but..."
"That doesn't sound like a nut," Miriam observed.
"Oh, I guess he's shrewd enough in money matters, but he's still a nut."
He began to laugh.
"Last year, I was collecting for the United Appeal, and I drew his name. He lives in this old ark of a house, all boarded up."
"On a hill?" asked Miriam.
"That's right. It's a great big lot of land with an iron fence all around."
"The children called it the haunted house," said Miriam. "Remember, David, when we drove by there? But it's all boarded up. I didn't think anybody lived there."
Maltzman nodded.
"That's because of the trees, but as you come up a long driveway, you see that it's only the top 2 floors that are boarded up. I drove up and rang the bell. From inside, somebody shouted, 'Come in, come in.' So I pushed the door open and found myself in this big room lit by one ceiling light with maybe a 25-watt bulb. Then I hear a voice that says, 'What is it, young man? What do you want? Speak up, young man. State your business.' Well, I look around and don't see anyone, and for a minute I thought the voice was coming through a loudspeaker, like in one of those spy films. Then I saw a couple of feet waving in the air. It was him. He was standing on his head in a corner of the room. Now, is he a nut or isn't he?"
"Lives alone, does he?" asked the rabbi.
"Uh-huh. Maybe has a day woman come in to cook and clean for him."
"And he has no family?"
Maltzman shook his head.
"So I understand."
"Then that accounts for it," said the rabbi. "He doesn't have anyone he's responsible to, so he doesn't have to worry about embarrassing anybody. He can say anything he likes or wear any kind of clothes, stand on his head when he feels like it.
Poor devil, I feel sorry for him.
But if he's an anti-Semite, David, said Miriam.
What's this, sneered Maltzman, turning the other cheek?
Not at all, said the rabbi. If it is anti-Semitism, it's irrational. And sometimes an irrationality can take hold of a man's mind if there's no one to oppose him or contradict him, or that he has to explain to, and then it's like being possessed by devils. A man shouldn't be entirely alone. Yes, I'd say he was to be pitied.
You mean if he had a wife or kids, then he'd have to behave himself?
Maybe, but it's been my experience that an anti-Semite is an anti-Semite is an anti-Semite. The only difference is that the one with a family and kids is apt to infect them, too. Right now, the question is the traffic lights.
Maybe if I went to see this Jordon, the rabbi began.
No, I'll take care of Jordon, and that's an order.
The rabbi colored at the peremptory tone, and Miriam lowered her eyes in sympathetic embarrassment. Maltzman noticed and promptly sought to make amends.
What I mean is that a man like Jordon takes a man like me to handle. I mean, it's a political matter and it takes political experience. Besides, I'm president of the temple, so it's my baby.
When Maltzman left, Miriam said,
I don't think he likes you, David.
Really? You mean you think he dislikes me?
She nodded.
He seemed friendly enough.
He colored and then smiled.
Except at the end there when he gave me my orders. And that was just a manner of speaking with him. I don't think he really meant it.
Oh, he was respectful enough, the way the army officers were always respectful when they talked to the chaplains. He thinks of himself as very much of a he-man. You're a scholar, and it's something he doesn't understand, and he's wary of it. And hostile.
Well, that's not unusual, his hostility, I mean, he said philosophically. I've had it from previous presidents and other members of the congregation, too. Doctors, lawyers, successful businessmen. I suppose they wonder why anyone would become a rabbi. Is this a job for a Jewish boy?
He laughed. Maybe they're right.
He could make trouble for you, she observed.
Of course he can. Other presidents have. From my first year. But it's 12 years now, and I'm still here.
But it's different now, David.
Why is it different?
Because there are new rules now. The board consists of only 15. It's like an executive committee. 8 members could vote you out, and they could do it just like that, she snapped her fingers. Because all you have is a 1-year contract.
It's the way I wanted it, he said stubbornly. I don't ever want to stay longer than I'm wanted.
I know, and I understand, but it makes it a little hard to plan ahead.
Chapter 3. Slouched down in his recliner, one long chino-clad leg crossed over the other, a worn laceless sneaker dangling from the upraised bony foot, Ellsworth Jordon reread with satisfaction the report on the selectmen's meeting in the local newspaper.
But can I make it stick? He asked of the empty room. Or will they vote on it at the next meeting? I think maybe I can get Al Megram to hold. I'll talk to him about it next time I see him at the club. But he's only one vote.
He tossed the newspaper on the floor and made a tent of his hands by pressing the fingertips together.
Let's see, there's Sturgis. He'll vote against almost anything that'll cost the town money, same as Blair. And Michener will vote for it, he added angrily. He got up and began to pace the room. So that leaves Cunningham. He's the swing vote.
He faced himself in the wall mirror.
He's the key. You realize that, don't you? All right.
Satisfied that he had convinced the image in the glass, he resumed his pacing.
So what do we know about Cunningham? He's retired, but he gets an occasional commission as the agent for the Steer Right Boat Company of Long Island. And the president of that company was here last summer and was crazy to buy my land on the point.
Once again he stopped in front of the mirror and looked sharply at his image.
Now what if I were to go down to New York and drop in to see him accidental-like?
and mention I might be induced to sell that piece of land if I weren't so upset about his Mr. Cunningham planning to vote for some unnecessary traffic lights. How do you suppose he'd respond to that?
The wrinkled face with the scrawny neck in the mirror smiled back at him. Then the pale blue eyes narrowed as he thought of what the trip would involve. He'd have to dress up in a regular suit, with a tie and shoes. He'd have to pack a bag and drive out to the airport, unless maybe Billy could take the morning off from the bank. But then he'd have to arrange to be met on his return. And what would he do in New York after he'd seen his man? What was his name? Lester. Yeah, what would he do after he'd seen Mr. Lester? The usual was out of the question since Hester was in Europe. So he'd have to sit in his hotel room and watch TV. Hell, he could watch TV at home. Besides, Lester might be out of town. It's not worth it, he announced. And resuming his seat in the recliner, he picked up his newspaper. Maybe I'll just talk to Cunningham, he said. In recent years, Ellsworth Jordon did not get to New York too often, but whenever he did, he tried to arrange matters so that he would spend some time with Hester Grimes, whom he had first met in the 50s when she was 22 and studying at the Actors' School. He was working for the prestigious architectural firm of Sloan, Cavendish, and Sullivan, and though almost 40, his rank was still that of junior architect. She was Esther Green in those days, thin, with jet black hair and large dark eyes, intense, serious, determined that someday she would play the great female dramatic roles, Nora, Lady Macbeth, Joan of Arc. He was tall and blonde and handsome. For all that, his hair was beginning to thin, and he was beginning to put on middle-aged weight. He treated her with a kind of whimsical gallantry, which she found all the more attractive because it was not common in the bohemian circle in which she moved. In spite of the disparity in their ages, they had been very much in love. For the 6 months or so that it lasted, it had been a hectic affair, marked by frequently violent quarrels, followed by teary reconciliations. Then his big chance came. He was to be sent to Berlin on a major project which would take several years to complete. He wanted her to go with him. She demurred. She had her own career to think of. And besides, although neither religious nor in any way connected with the Jewish community except by accident of birth, the thought of living in Germany was repugnant to her. The discussion quickly degenerated to an argument and then, as happened frequently with them, to a quarrel. Annoyed by her resistance, he was led to minimize the importance of her ambitions and then even to disparage acting itself as a valid art. "While I admit that it might be a legitimate way of earning a living," he declared loftily, "it is essentially one that appeals to a childish urge to show off." As for her reluctance to live in Germany, he felt that it showed that she still retained the paranoia of her race, and that it proved that she was still bound by a narrow ethnic parochialism. It ended, as so many of their quarrels did, with his agreeing with her that they were no good for each other, and leaving, as always, presumably never to return. Shortly after he went abroad, she discovered she was pregnant. Had he still been in the city, she would no doubt have arranged to get word to him, even if she would not herself have called him. And of course he would have come, and of course there would have been a reconciliation. And of course... But he was not in the city. He was 3,000 miles away. Had she had family, or if her friends and associates had been of the middle class in which she had grown up, she probably would have undergone an abortion, even if it would have involved the services of some quack in a sleazy tenement. Or she might have gone out of town and had her baby in secret, and then given it up for adoption. But her associates were all bohemian and long on ideals, especially where the necessity of living up to them was someone else's. When she suggested that she had even considered having the baby and bringing it up by herself, they immediately hailed the idea and warmly applauded her resolution. She did change her name to Hester Grimes, but that was for professional reasons.
It was almost 2 years before Ellsworth Jordon saw her again, and then it was on the TV screen. He had just returned from Berlin and was in his New York hotel room watching the late-night Damon Parker talk show when she appeared, dressed in a low-cut, skin-tight evening gown, to sing a blues ballad in a deep, throaty voice. Afterward, she offered her cheek to be kissed by the master of ceremonies and took her place on the dais with the other guests to spend the rest of the hour in idle chit-chat. From Damon Parker's questions about the progress of her career, it was obvious that, though not a regular, she had appeared on the program several times before. Later, she told an amusing story of the party she had held the day before her son's first birthday. Although her appearance on the screen had excited him, Jordon told himself firmly that he must close the door on the past and make no effort to see her, but the story of the birthday party made him change his mind. Why, on the basis of simple arithmetic, the boy must be his. Although she agreed to meet him, it was more to test herself than because she felt any desire to see him. And when he appeared at her apartment, she noted dispassionately that he was far less attractive physically than she remembered him. The skin at his throat sagged, and he looked old. "You've lost some weight, haven't you?" she remarked.
"That's right. I was sick, a mild heart attack. They wanted me to lose some weight and take it easy."
"I'm sorry." She was not really concerned, only polite.
"The boy, he's mine, isn't he?" he asked eagerly.
"No, Ellsworth, he's mine."
"You know what I mean."
"Yes, of course."
"Why didn't you let me know? Why didn't you get in touch with me? You could have got the address from the office here."
"What for, El?" she laughed. "So you could come back and marry me to give the baby a name? Or would you have insisted that I join you in Germany and have my baby there, or have it aborted there?
But damn it, Esther,
it's not easy having a baby, El, especially when you have to have it all alone. But once you live through it, then it's not so bad. From what I hear from some of my friends, there's a lot to be said for bringing up a child without the interference of a father."
He thought she was trying to hurt him, and he felt he had to retaliate. "That's the Jew in you," he said spitefully. "You enjoy suffering for the pleasure of making us feel guilty."
If his words cut, she did not show it. She shook her head. "No, you're wrong. There's no pleasure in suffering. Not for me, there isn't, but it doesn't last forever." She smiled. "And as it turns out, having Billy all by myself was the making of me."
"It gave you new depths of feeling, I suppose," he sneered.
She chuckled. "No. It was just that because of him I got my chance. I had got a job in this little nightclub. It didn't pay much, but then I wasn't very good. I'd sing a little, tell a few jokes, and do a couple of impersonations. But one night Damon Parker came in with a party, slumming, I suppose. After my act, he asked me to join the party, and I told him I had to beg back for Billy's night feeding. He's an emotional, sentimental guy, and he got all worked up when I told him that I was bringing up the baby myself. He saw me as an original, the new woman, and he invited me to appear on his show. Well, with the exposure I got, I was made."
"So I and the baby were just stepping stones to your career?"
"Something like that."
"All right, what about now, in the future?"
"What about it?"
"I have a share in the child. Billy is my son as much as he is yours."
"No, El, you have no share in him at all. What do you want to do, contribute to his support? I don't need it."
"I mean share in his upbringing, in his education. A boy needs a man to look up to, an image to model himself after. All the psychologists agree on that."
"Just the men psychologists, I expect," was her comment.
"Even if we don't get married, you could come down with him to visit with me at Barnard's Crossing. Then when he gets older, he can come down on his own summers."
"No, Al. I don't want him to know that you are his father."
"But sooner or later, you'll have to tell him. He'll ask, he'll want to know."
"Of course, and I've prepared for it. I've worked up a perfectly wonderful father for him, an idealist, a soldier who went off to war."
"Which war?"
"Well, That was a problem, of course, because there haven't been any wars recently, at least none that we've been engaged in. There are always military actions of one sort or another that mercenaries take part in, but I didn't want that for him. And then I thought of the Suez action of Britain, France, and Israel. It was over before Billy was born or conceived, but there's still a lot of unofficial fighting going on over there in the Middle East. So I worked up a young Israeli who came here to study. We met, and we fell in love. Then he had to return to Israel. I was to follow, and we were to get married there.
But he gets killed in some military skirmish?
Exactly. So I stay here to have my baby. Thinking it over afterward, and in his loneliness in Barnard's Crossing, he thought about it a good deal. It sometimes seemed to him that she had not been unconcerned and indifferent, that, on the contrary, she had been vindictive and had gone out of her way to hurt him. And he was inclined to interpret her attitude as an indication that deep down she still cared for him, that she had perhaps hoped to provoke him into a quarrel that would lead to a reconciliation. The thought was in back of his mind the next time he came to New York and arranged to see her. And it was never totally absent each of the times he saw her over the years. But there were also times when he brooded over her coldness, her lack of feeling. It was then that he thought she was trying to avenge herself, and that her consenting to see him whenever he came to New York was so she could enjoy the satisfaction of seeing his hurt. On the other hand, Billy was obviously always pleased to see him. Of course, it might be because he always brought a gift. But he was sure the boy really liked him. Whenever he tried to involve himself in Billy's development, she brusquely brushed him aside and refused to accept his advice or recognize his concern. And that hurt. She might talk about the boy's progress at school or problems that had developed, but it was as she might to a casual acquaintance and not as to one who had any involvement in the matter. It was on Jordan's most recent visit, however, that she seemed inclined to admit him to a share of their son. There had evidently been some crises, and her confidence in her ability to cope had been badly shaken. "He refuses to go to college," she announced tragically.
"Well, that's not so terrible," he remarked. "What's he want to do instead?"
"Nothing. He has no plans. He's not interested in anything. He doesn't read. He doesn't do anything. He just mopes."
"I expect he's tired. Tired of school and study. You've probably been pushing him hard to make good grades so that he can get into a good college, and he's just sick of books. Why not let him take a year off?"
"To do what?" she challenged.
"To work. Let him get a job."
"What can he do? He's not trained for anything."
"Well, it doesn't have to be a big executive type of job. Any job will do where he's kept busy and makes some money."
"And if he works for a couple of weeks and then quits?"
"Then insist that he get another job."
"But I won't be here. My agent has arranged a European tour for me."
"Oh, I see. What you're really interested in is having someone keep an eye on him. Tell you what, let him come and visit with me for a while."
Instantly she was suspicious. "So you can tell him you're his father and try to take him away from me?"
He laughed. "Oh, no, I'm not that much of a damn fool as to think I could compete with an Israeli war hero."
"Then why do you want him?"
"Well, because I am his father and I feel some responsibility. And it might be kind of nice to have a young person around. I had another heart attack last year. Nothing serious, but it's probably a good idea that I have someone in the house with me in the evening and at night. The housekeeper usually leaves right after she does the dinner dishes."
"You mean you want someone to look after you?"
"Oh, no, I don't need any looking after. It's just that it would be nice knowing someone was in the house at night. If anything were to happen, he could call a doctor."
"And what would he do all day long?"
"He'd work, of course. I could get him a job of some kind. I'm pretty well known in town. He's 18, 19?
18.
"I've got it," he said triumphantly.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.